So, welcome back everyone. Some YouTube hiccup. Not usually I click on new live stream, copy previous to have some metadata there. Somehow this didn't work. I tried 20 times in Chrome and Firefox, whatever, YouTube amazing man. Then I created a new one that worked, but as soon as I switched the latency to ultra low latency, that also failed. I did it again another time, also failed. Anyway, now we are, and then because with normal latency that did not fail, but what is also strange, you know, YouTube generated media, there's a stream ID. Usually the stream ID stays the same, and now went live in OBS, but YouTube didn't get live because then I figured YouTube assigns a new stream ID for random reasons. Strange stuff. This is how you easily can spend here 10-15 minutes fighting with YouTube when all you wanted is go live. Anyway, more updates to this cross-compiling stuff. Why do we even do this? Because cross-compiling means building compiling on one architecture for another, usually on fast x86 to ARM or PowerPC, but it can also be the other way around. If you have a super fast PowerPC, you can also obviously cross-compile from PowerPC to RISC-V or even from PowerPC to x86. Doesn't really matter. The reason we do this is we just don't have so fast Spark or even MIPS or MIPS64, although I have here one Origin 200, but even that is only 2 × 195, I think, megahertz, and even slower than my Octane, which again is also slow. With even my fastest Octane SKU is dual two processor 250 megahertz, and even that a total whopping like accumulated 500 megahertz in terms of instructions per second is not. You have seen the plenty of videos if you're interested, totally amazing Octane videos, which we will also continue with, because maybe even the next days, because I have an Origin 200 here for MIPS 64 goodness. So to give you an overview, as a previous live stream, my current amazing TMUX setup here, and now it's time to take a look what have we done in one day of 20% exacode free hobby time here. And the builds, so we have here ARM, because also Raspberry Pi, but also PowerPC, PowerPC 64, Spark 64, MIP 64, and the build errors were for some parts the same, except, let's zoom into this one, except this LVM2 on PowerPC, so much too, and my recurring joke here with the Debian people, which, maybe I stop this soon because maybe it's not so funny anymore. But the funny thing is, this is so hilarious, right? So one like major person of Debian, even from Berlin, and which I probably shouted out already in another live stream. And there you see, not that those people who also work on Spark and MIPS or something give you an email like, hey, you also do there this with this T2, I noticed you, maybe we meet for some beer or whatsoever, do some hacking together, something. No, they criticize you openly, like that you run an unsuccessful Wonman distribution and you should better join Debian. You know what, if you call me unsuccessful Wonman distribution, the last thing I want to do is join Debian. But yeah, there you see, I've never done this. We hung around with Gentoo people and whatsoever. I never called Debian or Gentoo unsuccessful Wonman people. Don't really understand the mindset, especially if you're already in Berlin and next door at some university and could hang out with some coding on some Spark, but whatever. And then they told me I basically do nothing. Here you see live on YouTube doing all the nothing for 20 years because everything just works, right? Yeah, everything just works. This everything just works, according to Debian people, is LVM2, and this error I also saw the last time, and I don't really, you see, I do so much nothing for 20 years that I already start to lose the overview, because this error, this is the assembler, the linker, you see here all the long path, unfortunately, source something whatsoever, this here at the end somewhere, and yeah, is the linker here, LD, GNU linker, and that is complaining here about the hidden symbol restgpr_28x in the library, actually libgcc, is referenced by DSO dynamic shared object or something, And I totally don't remember what I've done the last time. So maybe actually it could be because this is so everything builds. And you see also like hoping that upstream, like Debian, the mighty people of Debian, fixes maybe for me. It is the same error. So a couple of GCC updates, you would think this is a GCC bug. Already a couple of months. The last time I've built this, I don't know, January or something of that sort, or last year or December, is a bug is still there. And maybe the last time I even skipped this because this is only LVM2 and I thought, yeah, whatever, then I just don't, I usually on my small machines don't install with LVM logic volume management anyway, so yeah, whatever, then LVM2. However, this also you have seen in the previous live stream, this results in parted and also crypto setup not being in there. So yeah, you could also say maybe the last image I even said, yeah, okay, then it's not there. If you Google that, I think I Googled it previously, which is full. So there are also other people had the bug here already in GCC 4.71. And target out space, what enable target out, opt space, what is opt space? What is enable target opt space? No, I've never seen that. Anyway, there's a bug that has a similar for PowerPC 603E. Similar here of exactly that, and they only wrote here, yeah, they and as usual they closed it here on my display, they closed it here with invalid on the assumption that this is really an uclibc bug. Yeah, so this is they also said here, you see this among other things, so they wrote here, yeah, maybe not GCC LinkedIn whatsoever. So however, I'm neither using uclibc nor is this so totally old bug. There you see this bugs fixed sometimes, although this might be totally unrelated, but so much to everything just works and nobody, nothing to see. So I'm not really sure. It could be, I'm not really totally sure if maybe this, so they say this is a bug of the library, so this is somehow probably saving general purpose, maybe spilling them, not sure, I've not checked the source. Also, yeah, fun fact, decades ago, PowerPC usually just built for me, very rarely did I had issues, but yeah, 2019, PowerPC issues are back. Most of the other builds went quite well. Although here you see some errors, so I decided one thing, if you are interested in all this the details. We have some comments in the audience. The Graver booted up until ET system line, hot plug, no such file. This hot plug is okay. We need to remove this. This old stuff. You can ignore it. It's not even doing anything. Notice this shift 2, the head keyboard input problems on virtual machines. The last to manually this random keywords input all of a sudden think now what to blame for what you're talking about. You talk about screen or keyboard input problems with machines. So today, because also dietlibc doesn't build dietlibc, a very tiny dietlibc library from the famous security researcher Felix von Leitner here in Berlin. He wrote already over a decade ago, 15 years ago, a small dietlibc. Rock Linux was, fun fact, Rock Linux probably was not even me, I think maybe even other people, like maybe even Esten, Piotr Esten, there of now Icebreaker, FPGA fame, probably as far as I remember, so you see my memory, I can't remember what I've done the last time with the stupid GCC error, but I still remember who sent me this amazing patches, probably in the time when I was still a release maintainer, that Rock Linux stuff. And the reason we have used this is because we wanted a small initrd. Initially I tried to keep the glibc out of the initrd because other distributions have done that, maybe still do, I don't know, because the glibc is just so large. And this is why back in the day with gigahertz atlons or 2 gigahertz atlon 64 or something, I didn't want here some 1.5 megabyte, maybe even more plus other, so 2 megabyte or so of stuff in the initrd. When the initrd might have been, back in the day, the initrd might have been 4 megabyte, and then expanding a 4 megabyte initrd to 6 megabyte initrd just because of the glibc. However, so this is why I had some static stuff like mbutils and udiff. Actually, this is complicated stuff because you, in modern Linux systems, you need udiff already for booting up to creating the device node there, populating slash dev. And this complicated matters quite a bit because this meant that we had to build udiff twice. So our udiff package has a special setup of building with dietlibc for the initrd and then rebuilding again with the systemlibc, whatever that might be. Today I decided, because I'm really tired of like hunting and wasting days of my life after 20 years, it's probably fair, I'm really tired, as not only with Linux, but this breaking stuff, the most famous people, and they can't even get their libc maintained. So today I decided I'm done with it. The initrd nowadays is totally large anyway, of in the sorts of dash h, maybe even 20 megabytes here apparently, or 19 megabyte here on this, can't make this up. Why? Because this is a generic initrd with all the storage like IDEs, serial ATA, SCSI, NVMe, and all the additional stuff, plus crypto stuff, so lots of crypto and RAID and LVM modules, because our kernel is fully modular. But even if our kernel would not be fully modular, just for the most general purpose setup, you would have a super large kernel, because everything would be linked, of everything of what you may optionally maybe need, like crypto stuff, LVM logic volume management stuff and write stuff, would not be in the initrd but in the kernel. So yeah, whatever, either the kernel is larger or the initrd. Yeah, with the 90 megabyte initrd, it certainly doesn't matter if the initrd is a megabyte or two larger due to glibc. And I'm really tired of spending my lifetime fixing GCC, dietlibc, because certainly, according to Debian people, I've done nothing for 20 years. So today I decided I'm done with it, as this is why the build started with dietlibc, but now because I disabled, I took it out of the default config. So now T2 tells me, hey, I'm done building, but this file shouldn't be there because I started the build with them and now they are half there. This means dietlibc mbutils no longer in the default build. And although they are tiny if they build, which sometimes they don't, because yeah, people can't write makefiles in 2019, less stuff. Let's go there. So this is in target generic, the default package selection. On another note, which by the way, did we build Vim? Let's see, I've not really tested this. Let's, what do we have here? Vim, not. Let's see, do we not have Vim marked as cross-compile? Oh, we haven't. Yeah, another thing is, you have seen the previous live streams with Musl and stuff. For a decade I didn't update the small NVI, and now I updated it, and now it needs a BDB database. It doesn't really work quite right, and it's like, yeah, whatever. I'm also done with NVI. We now get Vim by default, and so this was not marked to cross-compile. Let's see only live here on YouTube. So this means a much probably nicer, because probably most people hated the feature reduced NVI. Only hardcore people like myself probably get away with using small, like a really classic NVI, because Vim, certainly everything in the kitchen thinks that you can't really call this VI anymore, as it's VI improved. So yeah, of course it doesn't just cross compile, because fun stuff like that. We could try to do this, maybe we do, but maybe I give you a quick rundown over other changes, because before we spend here 20 minutes of trying to get Vim to cross compile, which probably is an interesting topic. So what this means, as you see here, with svndi here, we deleted dietlibc. So this means also, so not only we make the default build less esoteric, like not this super esoteric alternative dietlibc and also building also less error prone, right? So not only dietlibc like usually fails, especially for non-x86, if someone like me doesn't fix it. And also mbutils, because mbutils also doesn't really build so nicely without dietlibc. I patched it sometimes, but yeah, whatever. Then we can also put the full binaries in there, maybe. NVI is out for Vim, maybe, if hopefully we can get it cross-compiled. And VLOG is a virtual console, like terminal text, Linux terminal, virtual terminal console thing to lock it for a password prompt. And I figured it didn't build with Musl because some UTMP something logging stuff. And this is why I thought it's super tiny, but I probably rather delete everything non-essential and make the default base builds of T2 even more basic to really have the, they are large enough. And yeah, taking the super small tools out doesn't save so much, but at least it saves me headache. For example, on those alternative Musl builds where VLOG anyway doesn't build because, yeah, reasons. And yeah, this means, of course, cleaning this up in T2, those default package pre-selection templates built on top of each other. And this means I deleted Vim from Minimal Desktop and BDB also, because we have BDB already in the Minimal Bootstrap stuff, because Subversion also needs this. So yeah, this is why I cleaned this up a little bit and some packages removed. Otherwise, how much changes do we have here after one build? Also, after one day, had to patch some stuff. So I had to patch libtrpc. This behaved really strangely, that it had the parse like user lib 64 in there. And this really behaved really strangely with libtool. Yeah, libtool, one of the other inventions that probably should not have been invented. Really strangely, that the system linker wouldn't find lib-l NLS, the native language support stuff there of glibc, because it had /user lib64 in there. And libtool did something really strange, that transforming this -l lib RTC into a full absolute parse. And I have no idea, and also I'm getting too tired of debugging this. So taking this out, taking this hardcoded -l lib64 fixed libtool to not transform the args in crazy ways, and the linker then correctly also find NLS. So yeah, whatever, is libtool the most amazing invention? And yeah, whatever. Bison, I only figured because my Bison is not the most latest, and something didn't build. What would that be? Something of, ah, yeah, right. Even like IPRoot 2 needs Bison to generate some parser stuff, and for the filter rules of firewalling or whatever stuff there. And this is why we bootstrap this. And I probably could have got away with just building Bison here natively to have the latest version, which right now I have here, whatever, on this old installation. Doesn't really, not mine, mine, but Q 271. Let's see what is the latest version here of whatever that is. 342, yeah, a couple of years later. And we didn't build this, so this change SVNDI also without best without space. So I changed this, adding this to stage zero, and then I also had to change a little bit more, because adding it to stage zero means in the bootstrap stage. And when you wondered why is T2 as first thing, we are building M4, Bison, Flex, GCC and stuff, because to be independent of the host system, because stuff even in my case here on some old virtual machine multiplexing VM node, stuff might be outdated a little bit, just to have to decouple and make sure that we have working stuff. And also we had here already some arrangements for cross compilation, but somehow I think this might not be needed anymore. At least I was thinking, why do we build this here with config prefix m4 equals m4? Not really sure. It looked suspicious to me, so I removed it. It built for me without it. And Also here we had here some hard-coded data parse and this didn't work for me. I have no idea. I could SVM blame, but whatever. Probably it was needed for something in the past, a decade ago, but this breaks. Bison didn't work, then it was using the host system like slash user lib share whatsoever, something of some Bison files. So this actually, this intentionally adding something broke something, so a little bit of vintage obsolete code deletion, therefore this for me to really work. So yeah, one day of building stuff, most stuff builds now. Vim we still need to fix. Also yeah, the Linux kernel does not yet build for all configurations as per usual. Some comments in the audience, let's get over those and then let's see if we can Vim to build, because certainly a distribution is much better if it includes an editor, at least a simple one for config text file stuff. I've noticed this, well, I had this already, okay, got stuck there, the hot plug on, but I get stuck there, hot plug on any ISO. If it's stuck there, it's not hot plug, right? Whatever it is, maybe I try to boot it in. All right, it could actually be here. Degraver is right. It could be something like switching some frame buffer or something of that sort, and then you don't have video output anymore of some Novo fame or whatever you said you have NVIDIA, right? That could actually be, but yeah. Welcome Glaucus, Christian Nano, or even, yeah, obviously, how you wonder, you've seen I also got away with using Echo and SED and Echo, I mean less, use less and Echo and SED. T28 minimal works flawless in VM. Yeah, so say you see a year of improvement and changes and stuff doesn't even work quite right. But thanks for the tip that VirtualBox works. I will probably try to build VirtualBox. We have, of course, a T2 package for VirtualBox. I can test in VirtualBox and see what is happening there for the new EFI enablement stuff. Maybe if it hangs there, most likely the Graver is on a right track there. It's graphic related. And maybe Novo or whatever module. And let's, maybe did I still have this in? No, I don't. Let's try, or we can ProPC64. Also, we could actually commit this here. So that was Bison. So only live here on this channel. Build Bison in Bootstrap stage 02 and fix cross build by deleting obsolete config code, whatever. Get the idea. What else do we have here? Maybe we commit already, or okay, maybe the target stuff we commit when we figured if we get VI to build. What was I also crypto setup needed proper guidance? Crypto setup, the usual stuff is cross compilation stuff. It was using the host lib gcrypt config, and this is why it linked the wrong path or something. So, yeah, also then here commit z fixed what was it? Crypt setup. Oops, darn it, no, I committed it accidentally with, it's only live on YouTube. Anyway, don't worry, like, can fix this later on the server. What was here with package develop GCC? This is only, I edited this and removed it, so revert that. This was some lib64 stuff that didn't really work the way it was supposed to. Also, yeah, Mason and Ninja do not yet cross build. This is some Python stuff. And yeah, I have here some to-dos. You see how much stuff is necessary. I need to adapt our initrd now that the mbutils are not there anymore. That is a small thing that is related to us, but also Perl, Mason, and Ninja do not cross build. Well, Perl was cross-built, but somehow each release of Perl it breaks because they constantly have to change their freaking make files. And let's maybe try to build that. So a couple of things. So this is far from being finished. Job one, vim, let's hope we didn't hit. Let's check that config. Proper C64 config in, this is currently being rewritten. Fun stuff. That is which you make sure get how to install correctly. Yeah, maybe you try. Have you tried, as the Graver so said, the image, the EFI image works in VirtualBox? Have you tried to boot and install this in VirtualBox? So said, yeah, so this is, so what we do, so this cross compilation stuff sometimes needs some guidance, and we do it with pre-filling, or usually at least with old-fashioned autoconf, which probably, yes, this looks like old-fashioned autoconf. Let's see, do we have here already? Probably not cross-compile stuff. No, also this identation looks a little bit off. I just today, which would this be? Maybe I have not yet committed this. And also we can actually commit this package network lib something PC thing, fix lib, what was in, let's not commit this again, only live on YouTube. So it's RPC or something, I guess, to, during cross builds. And did I commit this other thing already? I guess Linux Mason, I guess so. Anyway, we can just grep for this. So this would be some cache filling in any of the many packages here, like that one here, just from Xorg server as an example. So you can just pre-fill stuff that's to this cache. That is what we usually, or most people probably do for cross builds, which again, you don't really need to worry too much because we pre-document this here and set this up. So post make, maybe as I usually sort it, like, okay, post make, normally I would sort just slightly different. So usually I don't like moving code around too much, but you see here some post make stuff there at the top. And I usually like to have those functions and hooks together and not somewhere else. So I've not done that. And usually, yeah, I like this configure. I would have all this config stuff first and this other stuff later, but now it's already not in the most perfect order. At stage cross, okay, makes this a larger function if. Then phi. And so we need, a hook because we cannot just write it directly, because at the time the code runs, the source is not yet extracted. This is why we, this is why we need to hook this in there. So in this pre-configure hook, when the source is instructed, do here fancy stuff like this one. And I'm sure we will most likely have a couple of more ones like this. And by the way, personally, I find this to upper broken. No, I have the feeling we will have really many of those, which probably is, you know what, we could make this slightly differently. Vim cache, and make here function, because I'm pretty sure we have quite some of this. And then we can at stage add this hook once, cross head add this hook once, which, yeah, join this line here to that, and take this and make everything like this in one cache function there, like run vim cache and do that in here, which again we will have more of this probably soon. Like this should probably work. I'm pretty sure we'll have plenty of those, unfortunately. And yeah, I also find this slightly annoying. I would personally I don't like this configure checks very much, because many of the things, in my opinion, can be determined automatically. Yeah, cheesecake. We have patched this, so all this Perl cross-compilation helper stuff is in T2, just that it broke again. As per so often, vim to upper, why does this? Let's see, maybe we have done there something with a typo, otherwise wrong. Cache, creating auto config cache. Then let's change into there, run the debug, run the vim. You could always, again, if you're feeling like this Tetris puzzle, otherwise I will probably look into Perl. Again, personally, otherwise, if you're interested, you can also unpack ttorrent and try to patch to Perl and send the patch in. Let's see, evil config command, does it work like that? No, it doesn't, because now whatever. Let's hope copy and pasting. The only thing is with this, screen stuff, it might, oh hey, it even works in screen. Maybe this is an improvement over over screen with tmux. Config cache. Not really sure, did we do something wrong, or maybe we actually, no, this is ours, I think. Maybe we did something wrong then. Let's put them all in here. It's usually faster to do this like that, because to upper, do we some of this doesn't work, huh? Checking whether to upper is broken, configure cross compiling, please set vim. What? Source exec configure. Oh, I'm already in source. Wait a second, what is this now? Auto LS, seriously, one wrapper into another. Can't make this source auto. Can't make this up. So yeah, by the way, maybe you could even export this to the environment. Maybe, so you see, if you wrap this and wrap this, how do they run this? They run auto config status, auto configure source. Maybe this is why our config cache doesn't have an effect with the stupid wrapping of wrappers. Yeah, it's CDing, and it, which, by the way, I wonder if we can directly run it from here. By the way, do they have here only source or no? Yeah, you see, the more non-standard you do stuff, the more it breaks and is inconvenient. Let's try to run it from here and see if that works. Otherwise, it makes this a little bit more difficult to move the files to the right place. It still doesn't work. Maybe this is in find name config cache. Yeah, I had the feeling already that that is in there. Okay, cut config cache to auto configure. Let's try that again. And there you see how do you waste a minute or two or and spend your whole day with exactly such kind of stuff. It still doesn't work. Oh, come on. Please set auto conf. Oh, where did I even append this? Oh, I only here on this channel comments append this to the wrong file. Darn it. Ah, finally, something is happening. Would be surprised if it's the only one. Usually they need many, many more. With tlib, you need to install a terminal library, for example, in curses. So maybe it. But wait a second, it does say not suitable. Somehow I guess where do they have this config log in auto? What is the problem often is that they try to run those undefined reference to t undefined reference to t get end. What do they try to do here? Press the declaration of t get end. And curses library is usable, yes. Result. Yes, curses, what? Result, yes, curses library is not available. What the heck? It says result, yes, and then not suitable. Maybe they try to run it and that fails. So hidden this again. Maybe we have helpful comments in the audience. Installed but set crop doesn't install itself. Yeah, that is indeed use some manual. Yeah, I probably really need to next thing also do the grub iffy stuff that people can actually really successfully use it. Curses term loop temp cap. Please set term info. Come on, what does oh, I'm already in auto. As used, did I mistype this? Best pro tip, always copy and paste. I probably mistyped or something. Lib name not usable. Does it try to run this or what? If olibs xlibs core something cross compiling, yes, then fail or what? Or maybe say hard coded it so stupidly that for cross compiling it always fails or some bullshit like this. And yeah, when Guru Meditation writes autoconf scripts term, what was it, term lib equals n curses, was it something like that, or tlib, but maybe they still check it and it will still not work. Tlib always, always. They could still check it. Let's give it a try. It's of course, it's usually easier to just try it than reading all this shell gibberish in there. Cross-compiling, please. Yeah, thank you very much. Linking this library, yes, whether cterm info to what. Check whether we talk term info. Term info false. Term info no, probably. Let's try yes and cache. So apparently this overrides this check. It looks like that. Returns for an unknown terminal. What tget ends? Oh my god. And this is super annoying that, I mean, all those quirks and features, I would simply not write my editor so that it needs all this stuff. And maybe if it's something broken for something, then makes it in some if-dev Linux. This over-checking everything in autoconf, in my opinion, totally super annoying. Leave me in the comments what you think to that. It's just total waste of time of everyone. What did it want checking for? Here returns for unknown terminal. Filter on test program, yeah, no shit, Sherlock. This terminal doesn't exist. You could run this now for whatever, don't really care. I just want to mostly working VI now. If that was the right one. And this is what I mean with Rosetta code stone of library stuff here, cross compiling all this information. Of course, you can actually, this is something TTY group and continue it a little bit. Default permission group, cross compiling, please set and TTY mode. This means this is sharing this documentation, in my opinion, our nice stuff here, group, I don't know, TTY, let's check mode, is it, would it be 644, no idea, is this ones or other ones, TTY and, oh, it's not 644, but 640 maybe. Oops, also zero, not equal sign. Yeah, that does it. It's, in my opinion, it's also, first of all, the whole process is hilarious, right? This is the only thing that when I say more build systems here, autoconf was not the most amazing, and this certainly totally not. It's also here, get CVD broken. I mean, usually if all this broken stuff, usually I would say it's not broken because we're not DOS or Windows. The whole process hilarious, the whole checking, I would not even check this. If it's broken for something, makes this if-dev Linux Windows whatsoever. How many could this PC with that ignore slash? I don't totally care at all about such shit. Just give me an editor already. Let's say probably yes, what, or... you know what, the worst thing, I mean, they could have already seen defaults. Probably they remove it then, if they have code there to remove a trailing slash, then say ignores it, no, just remove it already. It could be, the unfortunate thing was, for this kind of thing, where is all the time going? You could sit here now 30 minutes and one after another add here all this stupid, not broken, pre-cached stuff shit. Yes, get over it already. Memmove handles overlap. Is this not what memmove was defined for? What bloody shit can you even test? I mean, seriously, there's really a limit of over-testing. Crazy. Crazy time-wasting stuff. And that is this, when I always say our 16 or so threads on Ryzen and stuff, hey, we auto-configured, can you believe it? The only thing is now probably here, it overwrote this file, obviously, which is slightly near. I probably should have saved it before. Yeah, that was not... No, I moved this here somehow. Our new Tmux toy. So we have scrollback. Let's RVS is super, but probably the VI. Yeah, the VI closed the string. No, I don't have the, all the effort, and you don't have this now nicely. So what could it be? How many lines do we have here? Set ruler, 200 lines down. Okay, let's try to 200. Can't be too bad, right? So this stuff, environment, don't care, function we didn't set, I think. Header we also didn't set. Lib, AC, POSIX, SE, socket. Size of CV sig compact glibc glib KNFS. So here's some VI. This is Mount Python. So if we are lucky, this are actually, wait a second, why is this? So looks like the special Vim stuff at the end. So memmove, stat term info, broken, looks like actually all the stuff we wanted to set, just that we don't want to set it so stupidly, but whatever, we do this in a second. So then copy config. Cache into the root directory. Also our file is wrapper prevented set. Vim source config cache. So yeah, set is where we call it a sandbox, which we also could modernize. So then let's try, does it build with that? Hopefully, maybe also like that. So if you're lucky, we can cross-compile. There you see, that is the reason why we had NVI. It is just so much smaller. Hey, we cross-compiled apparently. Does it also opt-install? Apparently, maybe. And then we need for cross-compilation configure. This and cursors. As it doesn't auto detect. So then let's put this into the config here, cross. So that would be read the file. So colon R reads the file here, also not X. Oops. Also, this is so then not, that is then source auto. And this is not only this one, but much more. Read config. I think, yeah. So all of this stuff we want in there. This this actually might already work, but we most likely do it slightly differently. And so cross compile. Add here to the var append extra conf opt. This hard coded for now. If we ever need something else than that. And then the only thing is cache. I will most likely use another syntax that like this one, because I like this slightly more, but it's slightly too esoteric for me to remember. Although I do this for decades, still not the most easy to remember, just this one. So cut append to also, by the way, we probably, okay, anyway, source auto this one and then to EOT, and that means we can indent this here nicely. If we wanted to, not sure if that's the most amazing, but maybe it is. And then we have here EOT, and this is probably how it's one of the more nice things. The only thing is, so no handles overlap, yes, slash, just removing this superfluous variable, default argument stuff here. Term info, yes, and zero, doesn't matter, whatever, probably mostly no, ttty and 640. Let's see if that cross builds, if we are super lucky. By the way, I finished packaging EFI boot manager, adding this EFI var dependency also. So that's now also there, which, by the way, fun fact, we most likely need to add to the default image there for those people who want to use this EFI boot manager stuff. Yes, yeah, so you see just cross-compile this, and again, this everything cross-compiled, although this vim is new, which I yeah, not found. I thought I added this, but maybe I overlooked something. At stage cross and append extra conf opt looks okay. Extra conf opt. Let's double check with what we have run here. This apparently not. Oh no, there it is though. Running, why did I not? There it is. Tlib and curses, why did it not work? And curses, yes. Use curses library is not terminal. Or we need to install terminal or curses. We specified though. Strange stuff always. Actually, wait a second, we run this cache file config cache. Slightly wondering, is this the right file? Should we maybe, because it's doing this stupid change dir stuff there. Maybe we make this PVD. Grab config script, set config file. Or it looks like it has already some provision for setting this. not config script. Okay, whatever. First we need this to build anyway. I wanted to polish it only a little bit. Because does it even use... Maybe it didn't even... Maybe we try to use this config file because maybe this is not in the cache and that is why it doesn't work, because it wants or needs this cache. Let's make a dot again, and if this doesn't work, we probably... Because we need two things anyway, then let's make it like that. Not that it has an influence for the outcome of what is not working right now, but yeah. Let's see, comments on, you basically have to install grep to manually. Comments cross compiling, please set. Okay, now it's maybe doing something. Wait a second, now this doesn't work anymore because that. Okay, let's see, we had here config cache. So it's already grepping for that in config script, so that means we probably can manually set this. Also, wait a second, set qconfig file, config export cache file, config cache. Does any package in T2 even use manually setting that? Mine is here doing. Okay, look at that though. So that probably, so mine is here doing our installer in glibc config. What? Why is glibc doing that? Anyway, maybe we can reuse this code snippet here in cross for. So this is run because then what was the code snippet anyway? Cache file. Because we need this here with the absolute parse probably to work like that. That was actually extra conf op. What was mine doing? Why is mine doing this in make opt? What the heck is even going on there? Let's see if that accidentally works. If not, then. Yeah, if it, by the way, it sounds already that it boots for Danny, right? So, because it still didn't work. Yeah, this is super annoying, the explicit path changing stuff there. So that is config cache here, right? Do we have everything we want in that file? Because as you see, there is more stuff in there from our automatic filling. That is already some... Ah, yeah, so here's our own stuff, and then that stuff, we only need to get it into cache, but this was only was grepping the config script, so we probably I really wonder, maybe it was added for one other strange package and it was deleted since then, that we have here support for stuff. I don't quite see it here right now. Let's try it just with this certainly did not work, so that there, and then config script equals it was like, what even was it in there? In config script, so we probably need can use var append config script and have this already in here like that, which probably it's script. Yeah. Let's see what that is doing. And that is the only drawback of this shell scripting, that sometimes it's a little bit 71. Can be at times a little bit tricky to get this exactly where you wanted it. So yeah, of course this can't cross-compile use host, still doesn't. So much to that. You know what, maybe we can, we basically don't really care too much. We can just add probably as the last thing to that should also just work, shouldn't it? Depending on where the base T2 script. So just making sure, because T2 apparently only uses a relative path dot slash, but this also, okay, let's see what we have run now. Running stuff and cache equals, yeah, this didn't expand, does it not run? If I config command echo eval echo conf opt, opt equals that and that, cache equals, yeah, this is this just because a cache file, did I use cache file for that? So we set this here eval config command at stage cross. So set this to drag config cache. Grep in config script cache file. Otherwise set it additionally, export cache file equals that. Cache file, and what do I run? Cache file equals. Yeah, lesson learned. Probably always understand the source completely and not spend your time. It's always so tempting to just try it, but then usually it doesn't really work and yeah, whatever. Config cache equals in config script and set. But wait a second, if it... What? No, this actually grabs positively. So if it is in there, it sets this. So if it... But wait, Q is only quiet, right? If grab that in... Ah, wait a second, this is in the config script, in the actual file. Ah, my bad. Then it's setting set the arguments here to the arguments plus cache file. And but this should mean that running this additionally with eval config command config command is here appending the options of clean conf opt config command for okay here are the arguments, so for the arguments wait a second, this adds this at the end. Okay, this is why this doesn't work, darn it. Because it's appending that. Could probably fix workaround this. The problem is always this changing this for every package, but maybe this should probably not break anything if we have this as first and everything later. Because this would allow us to actually redefine this, what we want to do here in config cache. Anyway, we should see this in the log, so config, was it cache file? Cache file equals that, and then, wait a second, but we only have one in there. Ah, you know what? This is strange. We only have one in there because it is grabbing the config command. You know what, this is funny. So this actually did not even work. Okay, then we, there you see, reading the source and fully understanding this. Don't even need to try this because it's grabbing the config command, which is a stupid proxy thing, which is why we don't even, so this did even had an effect. So always read your log, read your source, be sure what you are doing. Even I'm sometimes not sure what I'm doing. Then the only thing is probably it's not expanding this from what I've intentionally done here, cache file actually here with this PVD thing. The problem is the time, oh wait a second, we run this, oh no, we didn't run this at the hook. Because I'm pretty sure at that time we are of course not yet in the source unpacked dir, so okay, we can work around this because this will not be the right source dir. This will be one level up of the unpacked thing. But if we work around it, like setting it here in this cache with the other stuff, then we are... And again, if this would be a normal package, we wouldn't even have all this drama. This is only because we had this issue of the stuff source changing there two times. We also don't need this again if we... Right now, anyway, only need this one here. Yeah, all the efforts only because this VI is configure stuff, you name it. And because, yeah, again, only because we updated NVI and the new NVI is not amazing, of course. It still doesn't work because Vim2 upper is broken. Nah, damn it. I think finally this should work, but of course it doesn't. So what are we running now, hopefully with, so this is the full path to this config cache file. Maybe it's not supporting it then. Can't mix this up. It should, by the way, log which... Does it log which cache file it is using? Creating autoconfig cache. Maybe this doesn't even support this. Cache file, no, it has here. Why is this disabled? What do they mean with that? Alias for, okay, fine, but only in 2019 you need to debug this stupid autoconf. Does it support all the abbreviated stuff of that? That is funny. If all of this, let's see, previous cache file. But it's sourcing the cache file. Makes this up so much time for an editor. This is cache file. All this parse looks probably correct. Even the right file. But this is somehow not working because it's outputting creating cache files, so we are somehow not getting there. Maybe this disabled really means they have disabled it somewhere in there. This is really ridiculous. Could have long be done already. Oh no, doesn't disable that. Thank you very much. Or did I? Oh, I'm only live on YouTube. Reverse this fun stuff. Test auto, wait a second, so this is really auto config cache. This really doesn't work for some reason. Amazing stuff, but it's, is it even empty? Oh, thank you very much. Oh, it's a configure script. Config cache files, config cache. Ok, cache file somehow this does not compute cache file dev null. What the heck? Why does this freaking not work? Well, so many people watching this failing autoconf stuff. Even here, def null for some reason. Or do they overwrite this here in this configure? Oh, they overwrite this here in this configure. I can't make this shit up only live on this channel. Are you freaking kidding me? I mean, whatever you can work around cross compiling, you, I mean, seriously, you know what? I think I patch this away because the problem is. It would work if I just write it to this file, which is of course also possible, but the problem is that I don't want to change all the T2 scripts now because the T2 scripts are hard-coded right now to output all the defaults like size of all the int and pointer stuff to that file here. And then I would need to change T2 scripts also, so I rather patch this one configure stuff here now for that. Well, very theoretically, we could actually config status. Maybe we could even manually run this, like changing in there. But yeah, whatever. Maybe better try it like this. Of course, you can spend. So you see, you look at your source and all the package config stuff, and then the thing that's not working is this bloody. From the very beginning, I said this is also. It's hilarious. Also, one wrapper of another wrapper. There's really a limit. And hey, so it could have worked already 30 minutes ago if this stuff would not have been done so stupidly. Fix file diff autoconf. Or just config.cache.patch.cross. It's a little bit superfluous, but with that name, with cross, it's just applied with cross builds. We could certainly always apply it, but yeah, whatever. Let's see if that finally builds now. Then we could also test probably this live stream again, as per usual, when we do all this stuff here. No need to what? Maybe you can figure that out. No need to create the cache file yourself. What do you mean by that? We need to inject there some stuff. What do you mean with not? No need to create this file ourselves. What do we get now here? Error in vimdiff of file exists of view what? Failed to create zimlink. User bin view file exists. Where is it even? User bin x. Why do those file exists and is this not okay that they exist? Should this not install anyway? Yeah, a fine power PC executable, which fun fact we probably are don't I have even user or power what was the syntax? Power PC LPVD user Binden. Inhalt elf image for this y, maybe 64. But it also it takes 10 seconds of hey, a cross-compiled Vim and QA user emulation. Quality assurance. Not really sure why this installation doesn't work, so let's uninstall it here in 9RF per PC64 Vim. And let's try to build it again. But this is really, there you see, you spend 30 minutes debugging through the stupid autoconf stuff, and at the end it doesn't install because existing files. Degrever, you need to put some more context because, again, no need to create the cache file yourself. As you've seen, we need to add some more stuff in there, and it's more convenient to have all this automatics working. Also, if I said I could have done this just my 5 or so missing code lines, but yeah, some of it doesn't work. But I wanted just for the completeness have all the other T2 stuff, because as you have seen, T2 is also adding all the size of another default stuff that is good to have. I really wonder why it's now creating two times here. This was like view or something. So here it's actually CD. So it's doing this twice here for some reason over CD and then link. And then doing that again. What hilarious stuff is that? So running configure, running make install, and that's all there. Why is it doing there some linking twice? Crazy stuff. Okay, so we have here actually post make. We have here some gvim for, so because we have here two binaries or not, is vi replacement or not? So we have config vim huge GUI auto two binaries. Yes, is we actually two binaries? Maybe this two binaries thing is to blame. Maybe this doesn't work because not really building vim too often, to be honest. Maybe this two binary because we had this. Even in Rocklung's times, just as usual, people want options, and many people didn't want this monstrous, humongous GTK plus Vim binary stuff. And then we actually built it twice, eventually with a config option, so you can set a config option, not only which Vim features, because Vim is super important, as you see, deserves more config options than CLang or LLVM. And this also doesn't work because vim2op is broken. Did we not just patch this? Why does this now not count and exist up? Did we broke something off? I disable vim2binaries and the stuff doesn't? Wait a second. Or did it now build it? Now it built it twice actually. Okay, now it installed. What the heck is that? Esoteric, yeah, this is options and options keep stuff stupid simple. Why is this is also wrong? Vim two binaries equals one or not? This probably also hasn't worked in quite some time or what? What is this? But I have not, you see, more than one unsuccessful contributor here. Two binaries, it is a Boolean, so here this also, or did this no, that could not have worked like this. Are there more bugs like this? SDE config equals one, replacement one. Yeah, there is a binary comparison with one. By the way, fun fact, theoretically, while we are at it, this is also superfluous. You don't need this there for that, but not cause too many changes, no for nothing. Yeah, I guess that builds it then at least this double zoom linking was not Vim's fault. Probably I need to check that another day. Maybe we can figure out together, no need to create and manage to host my system by loop big mounting to a virtual disk image. Okay, what you've done there. So what did you mean as your back? What did you mean with not creating the cache file manually? I probably missed that note. So yeah, then we cross compile, actually, maybe if it doesn't fail, then what is failing now? Error, file exist, error vim, something, no, this still fails for some reason. Running configure, running make install, and that fails. Can't mix it up. Let's maybe build this for Spark 64 and see if it's in a clean build. This also fails, although we probably want to disable this two binaries. Build separate binaries, no. Ah, this has already, yeah, okay, then, whatever. A little bit saner, more simple defaults because why not? Let's maybe double check what this two binary stuff did. This two binary stuff did, yeah, running this again, obviously, without that, yeah. Yeah, this bug I really need to, at least inconvenience of cross-compiling this wrapper stuff and then it doesn't work anymore. I need to, wait a second, why does this? Was old config Spark 64 though? Why is there no Vim binary now for selection? Why is this not in there? Cross. Second, what? Why is Spark 64 PowerPC? Did I not accidentally change that while doing that? Okay, then let's build that for PowerPC 32, which was not. Oh, maybe I even was the Spark config more messed up. Minimal. No, it's a cross build though. Whatever was wrong with it. Yeah, anyway, you see these packages that just work. Config annoying, wrappers of hard coded cache stuff, not amazing. Yeah, maybe this, but it doesn't. I like this in the file more than setting it in the environment. The code is similar, which here maybe it could be slightly, but yeah, you need to export all of those in the environment. I like it slightly more to just have it in the file. Okay, so whatever is now messed up, actually maybe let's uninstall this Vim and try to build it. PowerPC 32 cross-compiled now. Again, I like it slightly more grouped and not. The environment is already quite large with all the T2 scripts and variables, and in my opinion, doesn't really hurt. Usually it works, just that this is one of the first package I encountered that is doing its stuff there a little bit hard-coded work around it additionally. Yeah, your mileage may vary. There you see different people, different taste and opinion. That's probably it for this live stream. Way too long. I didn't even expect that this Vim stuff now, yeah, 1:30, because yeah. What is wrong with this stuff, you know, still, that is hilarious. For the fun fact, let's do this for ARM. Then I would say it's too late and too long today anyway. Tomorrow also Raspberry Pi. Testing this ARM, I will most likely, by the way, fun fact, while we are at it, let's optimize, so we'll probably just for the total testing and over-optimization rebuild this ARM, so that is config if you do this T2 stuff yourself, scripts config, and then let's, because I've not chosen the right ARM core and that doesn't really matter too much, let's Raspberry Pi 0, Wikipedia, so let's check the correct ARM core in terms of like Intel Core i7 whatsoever in ARM terms. That is some, zero is using, not connector, which Broadcom is it precisely, launched whatever, yeah, $10, never got it for $10, system on check, can you not document it here, but I think the zero was using the same SOC as the first, right? CPU something, 32-bit quad core, somehow they don't have here all of those. Where would that be? ARM core, so that's some ARM 7 something whatsoever. Was quad core? How can this be so hidden? If a single USB port, ARM Raspberry Pi 0, ARM V6, can this not be Broadcom SOC? How can this be so difficult? Raspberry is use the same, so P0 is the same, something as the first generation, yeah, okay, just as I thought. And that was what precisely? P documentation. Yeah. So that is 2835, let's hope ARM peripherals, address map, I don't want the address map, I want the core down. How can it take so long to find the precise core? Let's see, datasheet errata actually. I don't really want errata, so I want the partial datasheet published here. Okay, finally, maybe. What? What? It's the same that I opened. Down at ARM core, where would the. Can this be so difficult? It's a couple of typos, some more serious than others. ARM 7.6, whatever. It's hilarious that this is so. Yeah, what I'm after is here the precise core, so for the optimization selections would be something like ARM 6, 7, whatever, ARM 28.3.5 version 7 or version 4. Here is something, Raspberry Pi. Here, this is what I was after. And I was on Wikipedia. Why did we not find this before ARM 4.7? Here we have something. But as usual, Google summary was, so I hope for that one. Let's try that again. We can optimize here. 4.7, so where's the 0? Here is 0. So ARM 11.7.6. Oops, ARM 11.7.6. Yeah, okay, so ARM 11. Yeah, also the ARM numbering historically super annoying in my opinion. This core stuff different. 7.6, probably something of that sort. Where's not even my Firefox? 6.11.7.6.jzf. Jzf should probably be that one. And then we probably can rebuild all the ARM stuff optimized to get the most performance out of. Hello, why is he now zooming? Oops. So, yeah, done quite some stuff. There is also maybe V. Can we also kill that? Don't really need the time. Yeah, so this will build a couple of hours. Of course, not that this is the highest performance, but if we already massively test here, this is rebuilding because the config ID changes. This is written so in the config script that if major stuff like architecture, optimization, and endiness and other stuff, if this config ID changes because the config ID is different, it's starting in a new sandbox build here. And that is then something for tomorrow. There is something with the kernel. My own injector kernel just boots. What do you mean by that? There is something with the kernel. My own injector kernel just boots. Which image did you use? The Musl Cling. The kernel was built with LLVM Cling, I guess, if you're using that image. Maybe that's something there. Although it booted on the MacBook, the Cling LLVM experience probably not the most amazing. Not only is it mostly not faster, usually even much slower, because of this massive C code stuff, and it makes not much sense to run something that's alternative right now. It's also said that a decade ago LLVM Cling was much faster, but feature bloat year after year, 10% after a decade, that accumulates quite a bit. So as much stuff not building right now, we will anyway soon continue with our own low level microkernel and other hardware low level tinkering stuff here, which certainly is hopefully more amazing. And it was a fun ride, an interesting experiment, but certainly nothing for your everyday use, not only LLVM, but Musl, not totally full-featured, and didn't even build Qt yet, so probably will stick for, actually battery's blinking, this stream will end in a second anyway, so I will stick for the most part with GCC, glibc builds. LLVM Cling was a fun ride. Anyway, I hope you learned something. See you the next days for ARM stuff, and there you see how much it just builds. Or not, and mostly not for the most part, as you see, but what I've done for two decades and why we are moving now a little bit more on, and even there a little bit less alternative, less esoteric, less diet libc, more regular stuff, and soon more regular builds. Oh, wait a second, I had a regular glibc build, right? So this is not, anyway, Soon, all the cross-compiled stuff, PowerPC, MIPS, Spark, for all the vintage Unix gear. Camera switching off. So thanks for tuning in. Hope to see you soon, and I hope you learn something.